Hello, nerds. This week, we have a very special guest, Steve Marchand from New Hampshire, one of the early original Yang 2020 team members. Steve, how should we start this conversation?
There's only one way. Hello, nerds.
Hello, nerds.
Hello, nerds.
Nerds for Yang. Some people may not be super familiar with who you are, Steve. So maybe we could just get a quick intro because you've got an interesting background and I want people to know who we've got on the show.
Well, thanks first for the opportunity. This is great. And the way that we're communicating to the masses is so different from a generation ago. And it's programs like this that help get the word out. So I'm a New Hampshire native. Born and raised in Manchester, New Hampshire. It's the state's biggest city. Went away. I'm a first generation American. My folks are from Quebec. Met in the States. Very blue collar. We filed bankruptcy when I was in high school because we didn't have insurance. My mom had a heart attack. We didn't have the money. You get the idea. Very blue collar background. Yeah. I go to Syracuse to be a sportscaster. And then after a year, realize I love sports, but that's not going to be my job. And I focus on public policy and eventually get a master's in public administration, an MPA. I then audit city, county, and state governments for a living, which I enjoyed. Meet my now wife, almost 18 years, and we moved to New Hampshire, for me back to New Hampshire. And we moved to the seacoast, to Portsmouth. After a couple of years, friends of mine said, stop complaining about how local governance is done because you audit cities and you should run for office. So I ran for city council at 29 years old, got elected, and then got elected mayor of my city at 31 years old. I did that for a period of time, loved it. We had kids. Life got really busy. That's the busy. And then hung my own shingle, did some more auditing work. I fast forward a little bit, was involved as the director of corporate relations for the University of New Hampshire. I was a last minute entrant for governor in 2016 on no money and no time, finished second in a primary. Then more recently in 2018, ran with a little more conventional time frame. I was not the establishment candidate. I was sort of the younger outsider candidate, got 42,000 votes in the primary, but finished second in the primary to a much more establishment candidate who then lost the general to the incumbent Republican. And so I've been involved in politics on the policy side, been a mayor, been a statewide candidate, and got a great network of friends, you know, tens of thousands of them around the state. Then I meet Andrew in January of 2019. We get a cup of coffee. I quickly realize, of course I'm going to like this guy. He's a 44-year-old, first-generation American, father of two who really likes math. That's me. And then by the time we get to April, I took him snowmobiling. We did some events together, and we really clicked. And that was when I made the decision. When you see somebody, you meet somebody who you think has a chance to make fundamental, positive change for the country that nobody else is pitching quite that way. If you wait, that's not how it works. So you got to jump in. I jumped in as a national senior advisor, and I've been up to my neck in it ever since, and I'm thrilled with it.
You are pre-Rogan, so you're old school.
Yeah, old
you
school.
Saw something. And I'm really curious, like as a mayor, a former mayor in New Hampshire, well-networked in, I'm guessing other candidates came and you met with them and, you know, you got to know them. And then you ended up supporting this, at that time, like the longest, one of the longest of long shots.
Yeah.
Right? Like he wasn't number six at that time.
He was not. He was so not.
So like what did your friends and your wife, like what did people say when you're like, hey, I'm going to get behind this Andrew Yang guy?
It's a good question. Yeah. And I've been around this stuff my whole life in New Hampshire. I mean, even as a 10-year-old, I was standing in a snowstorm holding a sign for Gary Hart the day that he came out of nowhere and beat a former vice president to blow out the New Hampshire primary, perhaps a prediction for next year as well, by the way. I like the underdog, first of all. I'm drawn to people that come from the outside because I think that's where big change occurs, and we need some big change right now. So my DNA is to give maybe more of a listen or a look to somebody in Andrew's position than the average activist or politician or office holder, that often as they get more into the political system, often politicians become safer. they become more small C conservative.
Yeah.
Because they feel they have a reputation or something that they have to uphold.
Yeah.
And that if you go with, and I'm not disrespecting these other candidates, if you go with Joe Biden or you go with Bernie or you go with Harris or Warren, there's an element of no one's ever going to say to you ever, what were you thinking? They may disagree with you, but they're never going to say that is outside the box to a place that's uncomfortable. When I signed on with Andrew, and I had the benefit as a New Hampshireite to have coffee with him one-on-one. Mm-hmm. I took him snowmobiling in Bartlett, New Hampshire. I stayed with him and the team at an Airbnb as I traveled with them in northern New Hampshire. That's not an opportunity most Americans get to really kick the tires on a presidential candidate. So I have that unique advantage. But I just, listening to him, mm-hmm. reading the material, watching early videos, watching him when the camera wasn't on, he has extraordinary intelligence. I think he's highly ethical. He has his eye a generation ahead, but understands that we don't have a generation to get to that place.
Mm-hmm.
The decisions we make now will impact 20 years from now. He communicates that in a way that's completely different from any other presidential candidate. And I did get to spend a lot of time with many of the other candidates, big names, smaller names, most of them. Mm-hmm. And I have great respect for the field. But if we're going to beat Donald Trump, the idea that we would pick somebody with a long Washington-centric resume, Donald Trump's greatest advantage is that despite being president for almost 3 years, he is still perceived as an outsider, which is very odd. So if you pick somebody who would be caricatured easily as an insider, you're giving Donald Trump his greatest strength. You're giving him that. If you pick somebody who is relatively old in the field, you're taking something that should be a disadvantage to Donald Trump because he's had some verbal stumbles. There's some genuine questions about his acuity. I'm trying to be, you know, polite about it.
Yeah.
But if you pick somebody who is the same age or older, and that may be open in at least one case to some of the same concerns, you're also taking that off the table. So to me, the best thing to beat an outsider who creates problems is not an insider. It's an outsider who solves problems. Karl Rove of the George W. Bush days has a saying, what's mine is mine, and what's yours we'll discuss. And I like that because I feel like we as Democrats, we have so many winning arguments on policy that can win back blue-collar America, as well as keep those that are maybe at the higher income, higher education levels, largely on the coasts, where we're doing well right now. But you know, I want to take back the things that Donald Trump is claiming as his, but are not, like entrepreneurship and acumen about the private sector and the clear perspective of an outsider versus an insider, dynamism and energy. Andrew had all these things, and the more time I spent with him, I saw somebody with a unique combination, a once-in-a-generation opportunity and skill set that could do amazing things for this country I love. And there you go.
Yeah. No, I it makes a ton of sense. Just as an example or for comparison, and out of curiosity, who were you originally backing in the last cycle in, I guess it was 2016?
16, yeah. I was a Bernie supporter in 16.
Yep. Yeah. You want to talk about liking underdogs. I was, do you remember Lawrence Lessig?
You bet I do. Oh, yeah?
I'm the guy that supported.
You were the supporter.
That's right. I still get emails from him. Yeah.
I've seen him in action many times here in New Hampshire. I would argue one of Andrew's best kind of pre-boomlet or pre-whatever you want to call it, early interviews is if folks have a chance to Google it, go on YouTube, and find this kind of good government forum that Lessig and Andrew did as a one-on-one.
Yeah.
One of the most emotional moments I've seen in the campaign from Andrew was at the close when he organically kind of got into why he was doing this. This is hard, you know?
Yeah.
And he talks about the kind of country that we're going to, and he's drawn to his kids very quickly and became emotional. It reminded me of at the gun forum in Iowa about 3 weeks ago. He became very emotional, and it was when he heard tragedy in a mom's voice and eyes.
Yeah.
And he thought of his kids. And it's one thing I love about Andrew is I'm a dad of two kids. My kids are a little bit older than his. Mm-hmm. But man, when you put the impact of what we're talking about these days into the spectrum, the prism of your kids.
Yeah.
That takes you to another level of commitment and passion. And Andrew's, the authenticity so often is most easily seen when his kids enter the conversation about impact. And Lessig, that conversation, mm-hmm. Lawrence was able to bring him there. And it was an awesome moment for Andrew early in the campaign.
Yeah, I will put a link to that video in the description below, because I agree. I think it's actually not as well known of an interview with Andrew as the other one. So I'm glad that we both like underdogs, and this one seems like we're in the playoffs. So who knows, right? Anything's possible.
Of course, you know, I think of this 24-horse crowded Kentucky Derby.
Yeah.
And there's a couple of them that are like, oh, well, that one's Secretariat. And there's Man of War. And then the gun goes off. And, you know, the horses begin to peel off, and some of them have now withdrawn from the race, obviously, yeah. Literally gone from the race. And I believe that Andrew is one of the few candidates in this field of now 20 officially who is objectively, quantitatively going upward.
Yeah.
There's a lot of candidates, especially the 10 that didn't make the debate stage. It's very difficult for them to argue that their trajectory is moving in a positive direction right now, despite some, you know, very talented people. Mm-hmm. And most of the 10 on the stage, you know, they're flat or going down. There are a few exceptions, but right. I would argue pound for pound, Andrew's trajectory is steeper upward than any other candidate at the moment.
Yeah, he feels like a high growth stock. And then there's a bunch of other blue chips that just are protecting what they have, kind of thing. So if I were an investor, I would definitely want to invest in this one. You know, one thing I'm curious about, Steve, is the snowmobiling.
That is
not a common way for people to get to know other people. And I'm just kind of curious, what did you learn about Andrew in those kind of off the record, kind of informal opportunities that you had that where you were like, oh, or was there a moment where you're like, oh, this is the guy? Was there a conversation or something that happened that kind of helped you solidify your belief that this is the guy to back?
Yeah. If there is a moment, it might have been in, I believe it was late March. And if folks search for this video, they'll find it. After I had coffee with him in January in Manchester, I stayed in touch with the campaign. Meanwhile, I did an event with Tulsi. I did an event with Swalwell. I was doing stuff with Inslee. You know, Warren called. I mean, the whole shebang. It's the New Hampshire thing.
Oh, yeah.
We were doing a thing where we put a mini camera on my dashboard, and I was driving candidates around saying, hey, I'll take you to events if in exchange we can do some Facebook Live. So we were doing like that. I mean, it was fun.
Yeah.
And we did that with Andrew as well. But we did a book talk in March, one-on-one, mm-hmm. in Plymouth at a Common Man restaurant near the highway. And my campaign manager from 2018, Christina Snell, who is now the state director for Andrew here in New Hampshire, and I think the world of, extraordinary, one of the most talented young politicos we have in New Hampshire, and I'm lucky that we've got this friendship that transferred into the Yang campaign. It's just, it's part of the success. She's a big part of the success. So she and I were working on this meeting, this book talk. So we show up, and there's this big camera setting up, and I'm like, oh, it must be Yang's campaign. It wasn't. C-SPAN had decided to cover the event at the last minute. Mm. So I'm like, well, I should have worn, like a nice shirt. So we had to set up the room differently because now it was going to get televised and all. And Andrew was not well known yet. But we ended up getting a good 80 people on a very cold weeknight to show up without being able to promote it as a C-SPAN event, Mm-hmm. So they recorded. And then it went an hour and 40 minutes, about 40 minutes of it. Conversation and then a good hour of Q&A, mm-hmm. basically based on the book. He was awesome. And during that conversation, I was not on the campaign yet.
Yeah.
there was a comfort level. Like we had live TV going on. We had 80 people in the audience. And yet I felt like it was the two of us having a really casual, intelligent conversation, candid. Then we got dinner at the same place. And Christina, the national team, myself, Andrew. And it was wonderful. And then I ended up staying with them at the Airbnb that night because we were going to campaign the next day up in northern New Hampshire. Mm. Christina had to peel off. She had another work commitment. And the rest of us went to this Airbnb. And it was great. I felt like I learned a lot. But it was during that interview that I was kind of like, this guy, like, I love the connection we have. And I love this guy. This guy's bringing it in a way that no one else is going to be able to bring it. And then it's going to be a question of, can he get better known? And will he continue to improve? Because he's never run for dog catcher before, you know?
Yeah.
And I think it's obvious. His skills, look at the debate difference. Look at June versus July.
Yeah.
Just look at that. The improvement is extraordinary. And it's because he's smart. He's great on his feet. He cares. He does the work. You know, he's a talented guy that's on a mission to do something really important and big for the country. And he'll put the work in for it. And you see the results of that in just the difference in the two debates. And I felt like I was seeing that talent that night. Then the snowmobiling was, we got a bunch of cameras, mm-hmm. digital from the campaign. He had never been snowmobiling before. And it was fun to see him in a completely foreign environment. Late winter, slushy snow. I grew up snowmobiling. I love it. It was a groomed trail, so it was safe. Mm-hmm. But you know, you could go 25, 30 miles an hour pretty easily with this giant helmet. You're wearing all the stuff. Meanwhile, we got cool digital cameras on other snowmobiles.
Right.
And within a few minutes, he was real good about it. I think it's a microcosm of how good he is on his feet. He was cool with just jumping on the snowmobile, get used to the feel. It's a little bit like a motorcycle, a little mm-hmm. bit. And then just letting it ride, you know, like go for it. And it was good.
So maybe we'll see that footage in a commercial someday.
Yeah, you know, I have not seen that footage. And I'll say this, in December and January, that when it's colder than it was that day and it's not as slushy, we got to go back out because now we're going to have a bunch of press that we're going to force to get on snowmobiles. If they want to watch them, they're going to have to go 30 miles an hour on a snowmobile too. And they do the two-man where you'll have, you know, the person who's good at snowmobiling.
Right.
And then in the back will be the person who will be taking pictures, right. You know, camera, this stuff. Yeah, but you don't want to be doing that by yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
That's not too good.
And it probably would have been harder to get the press to even consider that back then.
Oh, no one. I mean, we were thrilled that C-SPAN was willing to cover this event.
So they probably had the wrong address.
Right? Yeah, they thought that's right. They thought they had another event. They're like, well, we might as well stay. Right. Oh, yeah. I mean, and then this past Monday, a few days before we're doing this now, mm-hmm. Here in Portsmouth, we had our climate change plan rollout. We did it on the water on a beautiful day in Portsmouth. The amount of press we got, local, mm-hmm. regional, national press, was extraordinary. And Andrew did a great job. It's a very comprehensive plan, and it's very consistent with who he is. I mean, it's extremely deep, broad, it's thoughtful, it's data-driven, it's bold, and, you know, it's kind of like you got two positions out there. One is climate change is real, we should do something about it. The second is, I don't know if the science is real, let's just wait and see. Mm-hmm. And then there's this third position of Andrew's, which is, it's worse than you think.
Yeah,
you got to put the foot hardcore on the gas pedal, all of the above. And existential threat is not even exactly the right term, because the way I say, you know, if I say there's a threat of a burglar, that implies that the burglar may be outside looking for a way to get in. Mm-hmm. The burglar is in our house. Like, this is not a threat. The burglar is outside your door, and the intensity level needs to be like that. That's what climate change is.
Yeah. Do you know if Inslee said anything about the Yang climate plan, or has he
I've not heard it. I will say on last week, I was doing, this is before the rollout of the plan. Mm-hmm. I was in a town in New Hampshire doing a forum of surrogates specifically about environmental policy. And it was at 6 o'clock on a weeknight, maybe a Tuesday or something. And Inslee dropped out around 7 o'clock that night. And I would say, even though we did not have the full plan yet, there were a number of campaign surrogates there, but it was pretty obvious to most observers that the two campaigns that seemed to have it the most together on climate in that conversation were Yang, you know, and Inslee.
Right.
Inslee has a great plan and needs to be part of the discussion about climate because he's working so hard on it. And I think all the campaigns, including ours, are trying to build or continue the relationship with him to review plans and to provide advice and, you know, candor. But we were getting a lot of, in fact, one of Inslee's top New Hampshire supporters, obviously he was struggling, so he didn't have, you know, a lot of big names. But one of his top supporters, who's a town chair in one of our communities here in New Hampshire, immediately switched from Inslee to Yang the morning after Inslee dropped out and was at our climate change plan. That's his number one issue, and he thinks Yang has the best plan now that Inslee's out.
So, Steve, one thing I'm super curious about, you talk about rolling out that climate change plan. I would be curious about what was Andrew like in the development of that plan? What was his involvement? Yeah. And what was he like? Well,
first, in general, he's very intellectually curious. So, and I would describe him, this is the entrepreneur in him, I would say as an outcome-oriented person. So if the goal is to get to a carbon emission-free economy, then if you, that's the goal. So now you start to ask really good questions that drive you towards the goal, like whether you're talking about buildings, commercial and residential buildings that make up half of carbon emissions, or you're talking about transportation or any other silo in it. The question is, what can we do that can have a net positive impact on the economy and can aggressively meet the timeline for a carbon emission-free economy at the soonest date possible? And so that's the lens. He and the whole team were looking at. So we get there, I believe it's by 2049. So we got 30 years to go from where we are to carbon emission free. And if you look at the silos in the plan, which you can find on the website, you can see the fingerprints of Andrew's requests to the development of the plan. Show me the options. How can we do it aggressively? Give me the math of it. I got to be able to defend it. And there are certain silos where we can get there much faster than others. And that meant that we had to have separate conversations about transportation versus, say, buildings. But for example, by 2025 in the plan, all new vehicles would be carbon emission free vehicles. And then what happens with cars is over a period of years, you end up phasing out older cars for obvious reasons. And you get to a point where by sometime in the 2030s, there would be very few cars on the road that would still be traditional carbon emitting vehicles. Housing is a little different. And if you look at it, this part of what Andrew's, he's unafraid to invest the money if he can, if it can be demonstrated that it will deliver the results that he's seeking. I think there are some politicians that go, look, here's how much money I got.
Right.
I'm afraid to talk about money. What can I do for this money? He took it in a different direction. He said, I want carbon emission free. Show me the earliest date that we can do it within reason and then price it out in the most efficient way possible. As somebody who is an MPA and audit cities and was a real data-driven mayor and so forth, this is music to my ears. And I think this is a great reflection of exactly the kind of president he'll be.
Yeah, no, that sounds like a real CEO-like approach to looking at a big problem. And would be welcome, I think, in the field and in the White House, frankly. Awesome. Well, Steve, thank you so much for coming on the show. I can't wait to share this conversation with the rest of the nerds for Yang Nation. Is there anything else that you wanted to mention before we wrap up?
Well, yang2020.com, obviously, every time, anytime. And that's true for, and even if you don't live in an early state, New Hampshire, Iowa, South Carolina, Nevada, there are many ways that if you're a supporter of Andrew Yang, you can help in extremely real ways. And obviously it's the give $5 or $10 part. That's awesome. We need that. But also the virtual phone banking. We've got a very sophisticated digital and field team. We've got some great hires In fact, I've got interviews this afternoon to bring on some more field. And we have this fast-growing kind of yang-yang national network of virtual phone bankers that will aim at one of the early states each evening. Mm-hmm. And we're able to make some nights tens of thousands of phone calls in a matter of 2 to 3 hours because we have people from Seattle to San Diego to Texas, all over the country, who are participating in these phone banks. So yang2020.com, where there's a volunteer element,
yep.
You can click on that, and there's a way that you can sign up. It's easy to do. It's not scary. A lot of people want to talk about politics for a couple minutes, especially in the early states.
Mm-hmm.
And I can't tell you how much it helps us in New Hampshire in identifying prospective supporters. So the money's always great, and we need that. But that is a real way that you can help, even if you're not in New Hampshire or Iowa. And we appreciate all the yang gang love that we're already getting. And then I guess the last thing that helps us here in New Hampshire, you can follow Andrew, obviously, on Twitter. A lot of the action happens there. You can also follow me at Marchand Steve. And that's been blowing up with yang gang. And we use that to communicate messages, including links for volunteer help around the country. And I have deep love for the Yang Gang. It feels like family.
Well, I will be sure to put links to all of that below as well. And can't agree with you more. Everybody should try and pitch in, because if we get this done, we'll be making history and saving the country, maybe even changing the course of the world.
Saving the world. We got to save the world. And we're blessed. I feel like we've got, you know, we're in the front row of a potential generational change. Andrew's growing on a daily basis. It's a blessing to be able to be part of something important at an early stage, and the energy is infectious. So I appreciate the chance to be with you today, and gets me even more excited to have the conversation.
Well, let's get it done, Steve. Nerd power.
Nerd power indeed.
See you later, buddy.
Thank you very much. We'll see you soon.
We all generally right. Start the videos for this channel with hello nerds, like kind of like let's get ready to rumble, like a kind
yeah,
of a,
yeah.
You know, okay. So this is very,
all right, well,
this
is glad to do that.
This is the most important thing.
Okay, it's branding, we're branding.
That's right. So I'll start it, and then at some point I'll say, okay, Steve, how should we start off? And then you say, hello nerds.
Hello nerds.
There you go. Oh, yeah, you're a professional.
All right.
Hello, nerds. This week we have a very special guest. We have Steve. Steve, how do I pronounce your last
name? Oh, yeah. Marchand.
Marchand. It's not Marchand. Okay.
Right. I'm probably bastardizing the French by anglicizing it that way, but it is what it is.
Yeah, no, I hear you. I went to Bowdoin College, and then a French person in the office said, oh, it's actually pronounced Baudouin. But I was like, well, that's not how we do it.
Hey, too late for that. That's right.
Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang. Yeah, yeah. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang. Yeah. I want 1,000 a month, 1,000 a month. I want 1,000 a month, 1,000 a month. Let's get this bread. Freedom dividend. Are all y'all paying attention? Automation gonna sweep the nation unless we get him in. Andrew Yang 2020 freedom dividend. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang. Yeah, yeah. First we get this money, then on 420 he gonna give some high fives to some high guys. Decriminalize marijuana so we can smoke if we wanna. Down with the opioid trend, up with the mental health thing. Yeah, math. Yo, it's just math. Yo, it's simple math. Yo, can you do math? Yo, yo. Eliminate super PACs. Color stars making stacks. Student loan forgiveness plan.
Thank you.
Cops wearing cameras and climate change is real again.
Science rules.
Teachers bringing home some bread. Medicare for every citizen.
That's nice.
Andrew Yang 2020 freedom dividend. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang. Yeah, yeah. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang 2020. Yang Gang. Yeah, yeah.
Yo, a vote for anyone else is like negative $1,000 from your pocket every month.
What a cool story. Before we go into how you got connected with Andrew, I'm super curious, the sportscaster stuff.
Yes.
Did you go to Syracuse to study that, like broadcast journalism, or was it for a job in sportscasting?
Okay, good question. So for those that are watching that maybe love sports a lot, Syracuse is the unquestioned place in the country that you go if you want to become a sports broadcaster. So it's Mike Tirico and Bob Costas, Dick Stockton, Ian Eagle, Sean McDonough, Ted Koppel. I mean, it's Newhouse. It's the number one communication school in the country. So I was dual majoring in broadcast journalism with an eye on sportscasting and international relations at the Maxwell School, one of the best public affairs schools in the country. They gave me largely a free ride to go there at a time when our personal finances were at rock bottom, like I was mentioning earlier. So I was really lucky. It worked out. But after a year, the broadcasting element, I went to public relations. I stayed in Newhouse, but I knew sportscasting wasn't going to be my calling. But I continued on the communication skills track. And I'll tell you, one of the best decisions I ever made, if you can communicate in public, the written spoken word, it's going to help you no matter what job you do. It's something I tell my kids all the time, to the point where they're quite annoyed by it. and then the international relations minor in French and the public administration. That's where I wanted my career to go, is in public policy and public service. And I still love sports, though, a lot. And that's the place to go.
So if you're living in New Hampshire, and this is totally okay, it's totally okay if this is true.
Yep.
But does that mean like you're probably like a Patriots fan, or?
Oh, yes. I've been a Patriots fan my whole life. And for the first 27 years, I'm 45 now, for the first 27 years of my life, that meant you were cheering for a team that probably wasn't going too far. And this is true. So I got married November 3rd, 2001. My wife is not a sports fan. She has sort of soaked in elements of it through osmosis with me. So I'm a Patriots fan. We're dating. The team's not going anywhere. And then in September of 01, actually, it was the Sunday before 9/11 happened, 2 days before it happened. Drew Bledsoe was our star quarterback, and he got injured in a severe fashion, and we had to bring in, he was our star, we thought, and we had to bring in this kid as the backup, Tom Brady. And I remember just being like, oh no, like we're going to suck.
Yeah.
And of course Brady becomes Brady, but at first he wasn't Tom Brady yet, you know?
Yeah.
And we win the Super Bowl that year, and it is remarkable. You can tell how much I love this stuff. It is remarkable that Tom Brady took over the job about 2 months before I got married. We've been married almost 18 years now. We've moved a couple times. I've been a counselor and a mayor. I've run for, like, all life happened. We had two kids.
Yeah.
My two kids are starting their junior and freshman year of high school. And Tom Brady is still the quarterback.
I know. He needs to go.
It's, I mean, the thing I tell everybody, including my kids,
yeah,
you can tell they get annoyed easily at all this stuff. We've won the 6 Super Bowls. It's no franchise, no dynasty like this in football history, maybe sports history, short of the Yankees. When it's over, it's over. We've burned about 4 lifetimes worth of karma on this.
Yes.
And so I tell my kids, I don't care how many rings we got. Enjoy the season. Go for it, because when it's over, you'll never see it again. It is remarkable, and it has actually helped shape, it has changed the life of New Englanders. It's changed who we think we are a little bit. We went from kind of lovable losers with the Red Sox and the Patriots and all that to, you know, we've won every sports championship you can imagine. Hell, even my Syracuse Orange won a basketball championship in the last 15 years. It's unbelievable. So I'm walking on the clouds every day as a sports fan.
Well, I'm happy for you, Steve, that you like because I happen to be wearing a suit.
Oh, you know what, though? Sorry about that. Hey, you should have run the ball.
We totally
just run the ball. You had the beast mode.
I know we did. But if you look at the numbers,
yeah,
Marchand did not do consistently well on goal line runs.
And I did see that. And I'll say this: he almost
85% of the time it would have worked.
Oh yeah. Well, remember the play before.
Yeah.
It was a running play, and Lynch looks like he's going to get in the end zone with about a minute to go.
Yeah.
And I think Hightower does this one-arm tackle that trips him up and sets up the passing play. I love Russell Wilson though. I mean.
Oh yeah.
Seattle could be very good this year. They get some variance.
Well, you know, like the Hawks and like Brady in the early days, people underestimated them. You know, I mean, Russell Wilson was quote unquote too short.
Yes.
You know, Northwest, it's not like a real dynasty region. And maybe that's kind of like why I find the Yang 2020 campaign very appealing, right? Because if you go to Central Casting and you say, give me a presidential candidate, like an Asian guy that likes math is not the first thing that comes to mind.
No.
And a lot of people are like, well, he'll never make it. And so I have to admit, I did not learn about Andrew till after Joe Rogan.
Right.
I broke the number one rule, which is never ask a New England person about the Patriots. They'll just talk about Tom Brady, like, come on, enough. God. Enough.
Don't worry. He's only 42. This can't go on for more than another 10 years.
It's tiring. It's tiring always seeing them there. But I know if the Hawks were in the Super Bowl every other year, I would feel pretty good about it too. And
well, they're going to be good. Yeah. Seattle's going to be good. I think that folks tend to focus on other teams in the NFC. Because Seattle's in transition, especially on defense. But you got the franchise quarterback, you got Lockett, you have real talent.
Yeah.
And you have some young draft picks that are very promising. I could see Seattle going 7-9, but I could also see Seattle going 12-4 and making the Super Bowl. I think it's going to be a very interesting year for Seattle fans.
Yeah, and I also love our coach. I feel like he's not like a disciplinarian, kind of like, well, your guys' coach is a different style.
Different style. By the way, Pete Carroll, I mean, he was a Patriots coach.
He was, that's right.
And it didn't go well. But you know what? Look, Belichick was a coach for the Browns, and that went okay. They made the playoffs, but he wasn't Belichick yet. And I think for a lot of these coaches, you often have to learn once, go through it, and then you're much better the next time. Carroll is, you know, obviously one of the premier coaches. I think he's the oldest coach in the league, and yet he looks like the youngest.
Yeah. No, he still has his fastball for sure.